How many of you guys are excited for that series kicking off next week? It's going to be awesome. So I encourage you guys to get out here, come to one of our campuses. We're going to be starting the series next week. Pastor Ron will be kicking it off. And then the following week, we're going to have midweek life groups around the same topic. So you can either scan the QR or jump on the Church Center app to get signed up with one of our Signs of His Coming life groups. This is really one of those topics that you want to dialogue with in the context of community. You know, how many of you guys have ever met a weird end times person before? You're laughing because it's you. No, I'm just kidding. No, but this is really something that you want to dialogue with. I really encourage you to get out to Sundays as well as the midweek. So you could do that online. All right. Well, if I haven't had a chance to meet you yet, my name is Elena Ayala. I'm one of the executive pastors here at Harvest. So I'm so excited to be preaching to you today. Thank you. So Pastor Ron and Pastor Jennifer are actually traveling. They're ministering in Georgia this week. So we just bless them as they're out there together getting ready to just win Georgia for Jesus. Come on, they're planting a seed out there, making a deposit. So I'm excited to be with you today. And the title of my message is Choose Joy. So if you couldn't tell by these lovely graphics that we have here, we're talking about joy today. So I want you to take a look at your neighbor, give them the biggest, cheesiest, happy, smiley face you've got, and say, choose joy. I look at your other neighbor, just go a little cheesier, choose joy. All right, so how many of you guys believe that you can actually choose joy? Amen. Now, I'm not naive to the fact that speaking to a crowd this large and those joining us online, that there are people that are probably in situations right now that are not so joyful, right? So I want you to know that I didn't have these perfect people in mind when I put this message together. This is for the broken, for the hurting, for the people who need a touch from God, who need God to come through in their situation, because God's joy is supernatural and it's more than an emotion, right? So that's why you can choose joy. Because it's more than an emotion. If we could just choose our emotions, I'm sure no one would ever choose to be sad or to be angry or lonely, you know, all those negative emotions. Nobody would choose that if we were looking at, emotions only. But joy is actually a virtue, and it's something that we have access to by the Holy Spirit, and it's a supernatural joy. It's a joy that is beyond our circumstances, beyond what makes sense at times, and it's actually a substance to be encountered. The Bible talks a lot about the oil of joy. Now, I don't know about you, but I'm a very visual person, so when I think of the oil of joy, I think of something tangible. I think of something that I could touch, something that I can experience in my life. And if you've ever encountered the oil of joy before, raise your hand if you have. In a service, maybe at home in prayer, you've received supernatural joy. You know that it's something to be experienced. Now, joy is not only something that we have access to, it's something that God desires to pour out in our lives. He's not just saying, here it is if you want it. He actually says that it's actually one third of the kingdom, righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. So this is something that God desires for us to walk in. Now, as I was praying about this topic and what I would share with you, I just kept having these thoughts kind of roll through my mind. And so I wrote them down and it says, full force joy, in your face, torrential, over the top, ridiculously hilarious joy, unspeakable joy, crazy anointed joy, joy in everything. Just as you go from strength to strength, and glory to glory, that you would go from joy to joy to joy. Open heaven kind of joy. How many of you guys want open heaven kind of joy? Joy that's full of glory. Joy in your life. Joy in the midst of trouble. Joy in the midst of persecution. Joy over everything. That's what we have access to as believers, and that is God's will for our lives. Now, the concept of choosing joy might be difficult for us if, again, we're looking at joy as merely an emotion. But because joy is something to be experienced, something to be accessed, in the presence of God, we can actually choose to be joyful. And we're going to talk a bit about that today. The Bible says in James that we're to count it all joy when we go through various trials and testing and tribulations, things like that. So that's 100% not emotional joy. Because if you're going through a hard time, your first thought isn't like, yay, joy, right? But this is something that comes from the Holy Spirit that we can pull upon in the reservoir of our faith, in the things that we have deposited through a life of prayer and devotion from God. We begin to cultivate a well that we can draw from in our relationship with God. This kind of joy is deep-rooted, and it only comes from the Lord. So emotional joy, that's something that happens to us. Or you might say happiness is something that happens to us, as Pastor Ron has said in the past. But this kind of joy is something to be cultivated, something to be accessed. And we've all been around people who radiate joy. I want you right now to just think about the most joyful person you know. Are you thinking about them right now? The most joyful person you know, the person who you're like, I don't understand you, but you are so joyful. That joy is typically contagious. When you get around that person, you're typically, you know, faced to make one of two decisions. One is to enter in with them, to kind of let go of maybe some of the uptightness that you're walking through, or maybe the frustration or the anger, and you kind of just go with the flow. You're like, all right, it's a good day. I'm around this person, it's contagious. The other reaction at times is to actually become offended by a joyful person. I've been there before. How many of you guys have been there before? Thank you for telling the truth in church. God bless you, okay? There was actually a season in my life, if I'm being completely honest, when I would see joyful people and I would think to myself, like, you've never been through anything in your life. No wonder you're so joyful. I would think that. And I would think, well, you don't know the hardship of what I've gone through. You don't know what I'm going through, right? And I would get to know these people, and I would soon find out they had a story. And many of them had been through more things than I had gone through. And the joy that they walked in came because they paid a price, and they chose to be joyful and to trust Jesus despite the hard thing they were walking through. You know, choosing to be joyful takes more courage than choosing to be angry. Choosing to walk out and to reflect the nature of God, it takes more courage than to go with what our flesh wants us to do, which is to nurse our pain, to nurse our wound, to go into self-preservation and push everybody out. It takes more courage to be joyful. It takes more courage to show up with a smile on your face that's genuine from the Lord. Amen? So I'll never judge a joyful person again. It reminds me of, you know, when Jesus rebukes the I believe it was the Pharisees in the Bible when they're judging the worship of Mary. Do you remember that? She's pouring out her heart. She's pouring out this expensive ointment. She's blessing Jesus. And actually it was the disciples, Judas particularly. And he's like, this is a waste. This money should have been given to the poor. And he's like, you don't know what this is about. And I've come to realize that when people are walking through joy and they're demonstrating this fruit of the Spirit, I don't know their story, right? So I thank the Lord that they have joy because I don't know their story. I actually want to know their story when I see them walking in that kind of joy. How many of y'all remember going shopping during COVID? How many of you never want to go back to that ever again? Ever, right? Everything about it was just, bleh. I remember going to Costco and standing outside and watching them use these like big old industrial tanks, and they're spraying the carts down as if like, you know, there's some flesh-eating bacteria that's going to like kill everybody. Like, it was just crazy. And the fear was so contagious. Like, I remember somebody would walk by and they would like clear their throat, and everyone's like, ugh, get away. It's like, it was crazy. It was weird times. We lived through it. Hallelujah. Right? But it was weird. And we saw how contagious fear was. And if we know that the enemy can only copycat or counterfeit what God has established, then the attributes of God are potentially so much more powerful. They have potential to be more contagious and more impactful than anything that the enemy could do. So my question for you is, what would happen if the church became as joyful as the world was fearful? What would that look like? I think a lot more people would be getting saved. I think a lot more people would look at the gospel and say, hey, I think there's something in there for me. I think a lot more people would be less offended at Christians and the church if the people of God carried a spirit of joy that was peculiar to the world. The Bible says he calls us to be a peculiar people. I was just thinking about this video I had seen a while back. I tried to find it, and I definitely would not show it at church because there was like a whole lot of cussing in it. But there was this video I had seen that was floating around on social media, and there was this big public worship gathering that was happening. There were all these like violent protesters that were trying to like destroy the worship team's like equipment, and they were just like raging against this worship. Very just demonic attack happening. And so they actually got a copy of the video of one of these like domestic terrorist people from their phone, and they're saying, every time we yell at them, every time we break their stuff, they just won't stop singing. They won't stop being joyful, and they're tripping out because they're like seeing these people rejoicing. They're jumping around on the stage, and it's so weird to the world. How can these people be rejoicing right now? And I believe that was the anointing of joy that fell upon that gathering to show the world that we are part of a kingdom that is not of this world. That we have a vision of something so much bigger than what you can do to us. That's why I can count it all joy when I face persecution, right? Because it's the joy of the Lord that empowers me in those moments. Let me tell you how you won't receive joy. How many of you guys want to not receive joy? Good. Good answer. Nobody raised their hand. So I found the times where I get the most in trouble with this is when I start looking around at how I'm not being loved, how I'm not being served, how I'm not being honored. I get in the most trouble when I prioritize what people are doing to me over how I can serve, love, and honor God and other people. The fastest way to strip your joy is to go into that victim thinking and say, well, they don't even respect me. Well, they don't receive me. Oh, they have an attitude toward me. When I start shifting into that, it's a red flag for me that your joy is about to go with it. Because joy comes in serving, loving and honoring God and other people. And that's how we position ourselves to receive joy. We can choose joy in any circumstance. You know, I think about the people that I know that are the most joyful. Maybe you guys thought of the person that you know that's the most joyful. And they've been people who've gone through things. They've been people who have stories, who've overcome some really tough things. And I believe that every time we choose Jesus over our circumstance, over our pain, over our own desires, we get anointed from God. Our lives actually enlarge, and we're able to carry and steward more of the things of God. I want to tell you a quick story. This was years back. This is when I was in my salty phase, when I was like real bitter and everything. And I mentioned that I was, just offended at joyful people and all that. Remember that? So I was also leading the church's prophetic team at that time, so that's cool, you know. That's a great match. That's a great match. But anyways, we were in a service. It was a wonderful evening service. Everyone was kind of laid out and receiving prayer. It was just like a holy mess in here. It was beautiful. I was right there in the back of the room. I had my face down on the floor on the carpet, and I was just talking to the Lord. The Lord was healing my heart. He was doing a work in me. And I remember I was just crying, and I was just encountering the Lord. And I came up to the front. I sat on the front row. My friend was there. She was also encountering the Lord. We're both just like crying, and mascara's coming down our face. We're sharing our beautiful encounters with the Lord that we just had. And I remember this woman walks up to me that I hardly knew. Sweet lady, but I didn't know her really. And she said, hey, Elena, I'm just getting ready to leave. Can you prophesy to me? And I was like, what? I got mascara. mascara all over my face. I'm having a moment here, but I just stopped and I just looked at her and I said, Jesus, what do you want me to do right now? And I felt the Lord say, prophesy to this woman. Pray for her with all your heart, with all your might, with your compassion. Pray for this woman. And so I stood up, I wiped the tears off my face, and I began to pray for this woman as if I was praying for my own loved one. I went for it. And I felt like it really did bless her. And it was like shortly after that, I felt that my capacity to love people, it enlarged. Shortly after that, I went on a missions trip and I knew that something internally had happened with me. When I chose to trust Jesus and pull on the fruit of the Spirit and tap into the fruit of the Spirit and not nurse my own wound and nurse my own pain, something enlarged in me and I was able to carry more from the Lord. So if you need more joy, you got to push past your knee-jerk reaction to go into frustration, to go into anger, to go into offense. It's so easy. It takes more courage to be joyful and to trust the Lord than it does to do what comes naturally to you. Amen? I want to talk quickly about Nehemiah. Now, we sang that song earlier, "The Joy of the Lord is My Strength." It's a beautiful scripture. And I want to give you a little bit of a context of where that scripture comes from. So if you're not familiar with Nehemiah, Nehemiah was an Israelite who was living in Babylon. So around that time, the entire nation of Israel was taken into captivity by the Babylonians. They had to leave their land of Israel. They were all captive in Babylon. And after 70 years, exiles started to return back to the land of Israel. So there were quite a few that were back in Israel, and there was a lot that were still left in Babylon. Now, Nehemiah was still in Babylon, and he was actually employed as the king's cupbearer. So that was an important job at that time. So somebody who had gone to the land of Judah and Israel had come, and Nehemiah says, hey, how's it going over there? How's everybody doing? And they say, it's not good. The people are in distress. They're not doing well. The wall of the city is destroyed. It's broken down. There's no protection. The gates are burned. And when he hears this report, Nehemiah goes into mourning. He's like, it grips him. He goes into fasting and praying. And he's like, God, what is happening? Lord, what are you doing here? And he starts to feel like the Lord might be calling him to do something about this. He was so grieved that it said he went in and he performed his duty, you know, with the king, which is like drink the cup, make sure it's not poison. That's a nice job to have. So it says that he appeared before the king saddened. I think he didn't probably realize he looked sad because it was actually a really big risk to show up like that in those days. The king, they didn't have mercy, especially the Persian kings. They were known to basically like, you're done if you show up here with sorrow or you cause any sort of damper on what's happening here. And so it says that when the king noticed how sad Nehemiah was, it says Nehemiah was terrified. He probably was afraid for his life, I'm assuming. And so the king actually extends favor to him and he says, what are you requesting from me? And Nehemiah prays. I bet that was like the quickest prayer like anyone's ever prayed. You know, he's like, blah, blah, blah. You know, he prays and he says, okay, well, here's what I need. I would like you to send me to the land of Judah. I would like you to give me all the letters of clearance I need to get past all the red tape, all the people who would try to stop me on the way. I need you to provide all the timber and everything I need to basically get it done. That's a big ask. Right? But when you have the favor of the Lord on your life, a big ask is nothing to the Lord. So the king says, okay, how long are you going to be gone? Let's work it out. Go for it. He blessed him, gave him everything he needed. So let's fast forward. I'm going to skip through quite a bunch, but he starts the project. They start to build the wall. We've got a whole bunch of people that are coming to accuse and cause disruption to the work. They're trying to tell them, come down, you know, it's not worth it. They start getting false prophetic words. It's like a whole production to get Nehemiah and his team to stop building. Nehemiah, of course, stays focused. They build the wall, they complete it. But let me fast forward now to chapter 8. It says that Nehemiah and Ezra the priest, they bring all the people together who are there in Israel. And Ezra stands up on a little platform. Says it was a little wooden platform. I kind of want to picture what that looks like. But anyways, he stands up and he starts to read the book of the law, which is, you know, their Ten Commandments, the Bible, the commandments from Moses, the law of Moses. He starts to read it, and it says the people fall to their face in weeping and mourning, and they start to cry out, and you hear the sound of sorrow. And Nehemiah comes up, he says, hold on, this is a holy day to the Lord. And in verse 10, he says, don't mourn, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. And he speaks this word over a people. And I believe that they were mourning because they realized how greatly they had missed the mark. They hadn't heard the word of God read like that in a really long time. And they're hearing it and they're mourning. They're petrified. They're terrified because the standard that God has put forth, they have so clearly missed it. And they're putting the pieces together of this is why we ended up in exile. This is what this was all about. And they couldn't help but just go into mourning. And Nehemiah says, the joy of the Lord is your strength. Don't mourn. So he's speaking to a people who are mourning. And I might be speaking to people here today that are in mourning, that are struggling, that are feeling like, I don't know what to do. I'm in a hard place. And the word over you today is the same. The joy of the Lord is your strength. The joy of the Lord is your strength. I remember asking the Lord one time, I thought this was like a really deep question. And I said, God, how do we sustain joy? There's so much pain in our world. I can't even watch the news for more than 10 minutes because I just go into like overstimulated, like I just can't function. There's too much. It's too much in your face. There's wars, there's abuse, there's injustice. Things are breaking. You read an economic report. It's like, it's all bad. And I'm like, Lord, how do we sustain joy? Did you really mean that when you told us to rejoice in all things? Did you know that we were going to be going through these things? And the Lord, he's so wise in his answer. I said, how do we sustain joy? And he said, you don't sustain joy. Joy sustains you. And I was reminded of that passage. The joy of the Lord is your strength. You don't find joy because you've strong-armed your way through life, because you faked it till you made it. Nehemiah knew faking it through, right? His job was to show up happy. I can guarantee you he wasn't happy every time he showed up in front of the king. He learned to put on a false sense of joy. And I believe many people are showing up with a false sense of joy to not rock the boat and to not stir stuff up with maybe your job or maybe things are going on. You were never meant to carry that weight alone. The joy of the Lord is your strength. And that joy only comes from Jesus. Hebrews 12:2 says, because of the joy awaiting him, he endured the cross, disregarding its shame. Now he is seated in the place of honor beside God's throne. You know, it was joy that actually sustained Jesus as he was headed to the cross. That's a powerful thing. He looked at what was about to happen to him. The Bible said he fully knew what was about to happen to him. His eyes were open. He knew the ridicule. He knew the abuse. He knew the rejection, the abandonment, the weight, the pain, even just in his physical body. He knew everything that was about to happen. And it says, because of the joy awaiting him, he endured the cross, disregarding its shame. He had a vision of something bigger than himself. He saw you. He saw me. He saw the glory of God and what was on the other side of it. It was joy that sustained him. Now, practically, I'm going to give you three ways that you can access joy. Number one, we live joyfully by walking in the Spirit. Galatians 5:16 says, so I say, let the Holy Spirit guide your lives. Then you won't be doing what your sinful nature craves. The sinful nature wants to do evil, which is just the opposite of what the Spirit wants. And the Spirit gives us desires that are opposite of what the sinful nature desires. These two forces are constantly fighting each other so that you're not free to carry out your good intentions. So in other words, when you let the Holy Spirit guide your life, you can rise above those knee-jerk reactions to go into anger and all that, as I mentioned before. Let the Holy Spirit guide your life, and you're positioned to walk in joy. Galatians 5:22, but the Holy Spirit produces this kind of fruit in our lives: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. There is no law against these things. So proof that you're being led by the Spirit is that you have the fruit of the Spirit, which are those attributes I just read there. One of them is joy. So fruit doesn't lie. I mean, that's a whole teaching for another day. The fruit of our lives doesn't lie. So if I am walking around with things that are not good fruit, I need more of the Holy Spirit. I need him to guide my life and to lead my life. You know, the Bible says, blessed is he who hears and obeys. You know, many of us, we confuse hearing the word of God and obeying the word of God. It's two parts. So a lot of us hear from God. We might feel the presence of God. We feel that God is speaking to us. We hear him, but that's only half the equation. The other side of it is actually do what he said to do. And the fruit that you're doing that is that you have love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, self-control, right? Galatians 5:25. Since we are living by the Spirit, let us follow the Spirit's leading in every part of our lives. That means there's nothing off limits to what this can encompass in our lives. Number two, every day stay sweet, because you don't get hard-hearted overnight. Come on. You don't get hard-hearted overnight. The corrosion of joy is what happens in the day in, day out. Another bad day, another bad season, another day trying to do it all on my own. Stay sweet, because you don't get hard-hearted overnight. Nobody wakes up one day and says, I want to have a hard heart. If you do, we will pray for you after service. Please come to the front. We'd love to pray for you. Lead you to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Nobody wakes up one day and says, I want to be the go-to person for criticism. Like if someone's going to have a complaint, like I hope they know it's going to be me, right? Nobody wakes up and thinks like that. The corrosion of joy happens a little over time. It's the ebb and flow of our life. But if we don't bring those things to the Lord, walking in the Spirit, staying sweet, keeping our hearts right, those things tack on us and they become pockets of stones in our heart. And the Bible says in the parable of the sower that stony places actually prohibit the word from taking root in us, because we get hard spots. Hebrews 12:1, therefore, since we are surrounded by such a huge crowd of witnesses to the life of faith, let us strip off every weight that slows us down, especially the sin that so easily trips us up, and let us run with endurance the race God has set before us. I'm going to read that same passage in the Passion Translation. As for us, we have all these great witnesses who encircle us like clouds, so we must let go of every wound that has pierced us and the sin we so easily fall into. Then we'll be able to run life's marathon race with passion and determination, for the path has already been marked out for us. You notice there was a swapping of words in those translations. The first one, it says that the weights that weigh us down. The other translation said the wounds that weigh us down. I think sometimes we discount the connection between wounding and sinning. Did you know that you are more likely to sin when you're in pain? You're more likely to justify sin when you're hurting and in pain and you're wounded. But this passage is telling us you got to deal with those things because they're slowing you down. The very next verse to that one is the one we read earlier. Because of the joy awaiting him, this is verse 2, he endured the cross, disregarding its shame. Now he is seated in the place of honor beside God's throne. It says we do this by keeping our eyes on Jesus. So we've got to get a revelation of Jesus. What does it mean to get a revelation of Jesus? It means you see him. He's revealed to you. You see him for who he is. You see him as he is. I think a lot of us lack joy because we don't see Jesus as he truly is. And therefore, we don't see ourselves the way he's made us to be. I want to take some time as the worship team comes up. You know, we didn't do this first service, and I really felt like we needed to do this at this service. But I want to pray that God would unleash such joy in this room and those joining us online, that it would break all depression, that it would break all anxiety, that it would remove the heaviness and the pain and the fear that has so entangled so many of us. You don't have to be in sin to need more joy. I need more joy. I need the oil of joy to touch my life. I get cranky. Do you get cranky? Man, I get cranky sometimes. I need more joy.